Oh, hey everybody, sorry for the delay. We're here with two-time legendary Tony Award Judy Kay. How are you today?
Oh, pretty good. I'm much better for seeing you.
Thank you. So what's been going on in Diana?
Wow, Diana, you'll see the stage managers gave us plates. So that's evidence that I was in Diana right there. Yeah. And opening that gift from the stage manager. It's very hard to work that hard on something with all your heart and soul for 5 years, you know. I was part of the project from not exactly the inception, although your friend and mine, Jody Pietro, did write me and say he had written what he thought was a part for me, or two parts, as we should say. And I was only too thrilled to be part of what he wrote. It was a great gift. The whole thing was a great gift, but it's sad when it closes, especially so fast.
Yeah. And, let's take a look at what you said about being in Diana. It's the last one.
I am Judy Kay, and I play Queen Elizabeth. I didn't have an audition for this role. Jody Pietro, our wonderful, wonderful book writer and lyricist, he called me one day and he said, I think I might have written something for you. I couldn't have been more thrilled. What a gift. The show is a dramatization of real events, and we are the people entrusted with the story. So that's kind of how I feel about it. I'm like, I've been given a sort of a sacred job here, and I'm just going to try to embody her and tell her side of this incredible tale.
Now, what was it like playing Elizabeth?
It was really fun. It was really fun. I mean, I have fun doing what I do. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't do it. You know, I mean, I think if you ask most people who are in the theater, who are actors especially, we do it because we love it. And I had a great time playing Elizabeth. I mean, she was, you know, this, we had to say that this, it was Elizabeth in a musical, not Elizabeth in life, not a documentary about Diana or Elizabeth or Charles or any of these folks. It was a musical and a incredibly entertaining one for the people who watched it. Obviously, I saw the audiences going crazy for it, and it was entertaining for me. I loved playing her as she was written, with her wit and her heart, her passion and her generosity of spirit, in my opinion. And I loved doing it.
How hard is it to play a split track?
Oh, that's fun. That's fun because, you know, you're playing one character who's Elizabeth. This particular piece is pretty serious. You know, she was fit to be tied, as they say, about her son and his inability to find a mate and get on with his life. And then in her opinion, sort of somehow not making the marriage work. So she was kind of pissed off all the time in a way. But then you had the flip side of Queen Elizabeth playing Barbara Cartland, who truly, I mean, you can actually Google her. You will find videos of her being interviewed. You can see how she really, really was. And she was pretty off the wall. She was smart, really smart, but what a character, what a character. So it was really fun. I mean, you go off into the wings and quickly change your clothes and come back on, and instead of you were hats and horns, as we would say. It was really fun to do. I had never done that before. Well, no, that's not true. I did a show called Mooney Shapiro Songbook, There were five actors playing 90 characters, and
Oh.
I had something like 35 costume changes, and I had the least of them. And that was fun. That was fun because you go off the wings, turn back around, and go back out as someone totally different. And
Yeah.
I learned a lot. And this was great fun. This was a ball.
Now, when you play a split track, do you highlight in different colors so you can figure out what track you are? Like Elizabeth in blue or purple, and then Barbara is like yellow or green.
You mean what do I use as a highlighter in my script?
How do you highlight a split track? Is it all
Well, you
one?
know, I don't think I used two different markers for her. I think I used different tab colors on the edges of the pages when I was learning it.
Yeah.
But once I, of course, I once I had it in here and here. This is pretty empty usually, so there's a lot of stuff that's in there at any given time. So that was, I didn't really have to delineate so much because, well, the Queen was very, very definite, and Barbara was, you know, had just crazy, you know, hot pink at all times. And I did have a dresser. I have a brilliant friend and dresser who makes sure I don't screw up and march out on the stage in the wrong costume at any given time.
I could be wrong, but I heard a little Duchess Estonia Zorro.
Well, there's a the, you know,
a,
they have a lot in common.
A little of it. I mean,
yeah, Barbara and Estonia have a lot in common, don't you think?
No, when you play the Queen, I
the Queen,
heard
really?
It. Yeah, when you use that accent, I heard a little Duchess Estonia in there.
Well, you know, Estonia was what we would call mid-Atlantic. Now, she was, that character was derived from something like the Downton Abbey character, the American who the wealthy American woman who marries a Brit. Okay, that was a whole thing. During Edwardian times, I guess. I was going to be Edwardian. Well, yeah, late 19th century, okay? And so those women were taught to have what they sort of called a mid-Atlantic dialect. And so it was somewhere in the middle of the ocean. So a little American and a little bit of Brit. And so, but I learned I was taught a very specific dialect for the Queen. We had a really marvelous dialect coach, Liz, brilliant Liz. And if you talk to the women who have played the Queen in The Crown and all, we have to learn a very, very specific British accent. It's not like just sort of upper class. It's very pinched, and so it's different. The mouth barely moves. And it's a little hard to do in a musical because at some point you're going to have to open your mouth and go, ah! So it was crazy. But yes, of course, I'm sure there was, you know, it's the same actor playing both parts. So what you're seeing is probably me in the middle of all of that.
Yeah,
me playing the.
I could have been wrong.
No,
but I could I heard a little bit of that. What was it like, you know, winning your first Tony?
It was an out-of-body experience. It was extraordinary. It was... I can't even explain it. I mean, I think it's, if you were to imagine anybody in their lives, whatever they do, suddenly being recognized that way, and that in a public way on television in front of the world and being given this beautiful statuette, I think everybody would be, it's breathtaking. It just it takes your breath away.
Yeah,
and it just feels so good to know that your peers, because the people who vote are the people you work with, you know, and they think that you're worthy of that. And it was incredible. It was incredible.
Yeah, I happen to have the video clip.
Oh, okay.
No.
Thank you. Good evening. Nell and I were here to present this year's Tonys for the outstanding featured performers in a musical.
Just a minute. Excuse me. I want to tell you something about this award, you know, just in case. You see, there's this big spotlight, you know, and it's real bright, and it's just room for somebody else to be behind them. They're singing and dancing and supporting.
Thank you.
I mean, that's their job. I'm not through. That's their job to support. Now, that's a nice job and all, but sometimes if you sing loud enough or you kick high enough, excuse me, darling, if you do this, some of that spotlight will spill over on you, and I like that better. You want to say something? Go ahead.
How about good night, Nell? Right. The nominees for the best performance by a featured actress in a musical are Judy Kay, The Phantom of the Opera. Lolito Kumala Sarafina. Alison Reed, Cabaret. Regina Resnick, Cabaret. And the winner is
Judy Kay. These are things that do happen. As my rabbi said last year when I was getting married, how long we have waited for this day. I love this so much. And I love being back here on Broadway. I loved doing 62 cities in 18 weeks. Don't get me wrong. It was wonderful. But to be back here, and thank you. Thank you to all my friends and colleagues in the New York Theater, to the nominating committee, to the voters, all of you, and to my fellow nominees, I honor you. Thank you to Hal and to Andrew and to Maria for those gorgeous trains I get to kick around, and to Jillian, to David Caddick for keeping me on pitch, and to everyone associated with Phantom of the Opera. And of course to my folks who have been to so many openings with me, some of them have been closings as well. Thank you for hanging in there. To my dear, darling David Green, thank you for helping me keep things in perspective, my husband. Thank you. I love you. The cast, crew, musicians at the Majestic, you make magic happen 8 times a week. I'm proud to be one of you. And here's to absent friends.
Thank you. What was going through your head then?
What was going on in my head? Not a whole lot. I was just taking in the moment and blabbing and blabbing and blabbing. And I wondered what had possessed me to get that dress with those things on my shoulders. I don't know. They looked like they needed to be lanced, actually. But I did sell it at one of the flea market sales, so somebody's got that dress.
Someone's got it. I was the one talking to James Monroe, and he said, winning a Tony is like everything it's in slow motion, like you're going in slow motion.
Kind of, yeah. Listen, it's a combination of slow motion and totally speeded up at the same time. It's just, and then if you're the first person, like I was that year, the first award went to a featured actress. So what do? When that happens, they whisk you away and they take, at that time it was across the street from Sardi's. It was, the Minskoff, and they hustled me over there and I never got to see the rest of the show. I was so upset. I went back to do, that was the other one, the first one where I did my number. We didn't get to do anything. So I was sort of stuck being interviewed by people. I call it the sort of the stations of the cross, where you go from person to person to person being interviewed. And then when they're done with you, you're not allowed to go back to your seat and watch the show. So I just found a video monitor and sat there and watched and drank wine and watched. The whole thing was an extraordinary, really out of body experience. And then I went through it again. It was different the second time, a little different, because I was sharing it with somebody, which made it very, very special. Sharing it with Michael McGraw and Nice Work was extraordinary. Yeah. Really special.
Yeah. How long were you in Phantom?
Just a year. I went in, I did it for a year, but I was asked to do some other things, and I had gone to Hal and said, because he had the habit of letting people go and do something and then come back. But I was offered a couple of things and he said, I can't let you out that long. And I sort of waited and I thought, man, I love doing this and I love working for him especially. But I needed to do, I had opportunities to do some other things, an opera. Oh my God, big, big, scary opera, playing a major role. And then I got to do Pajama Game, his old show. I got to do Pajama Game with the City Opera at the Lincoln Center. So after that, he said, no, you can't. You either have to leave and do that or stick around. But then I went into the show on the road. I subbed in a couple of times in LA. And that was fun getting to revisit it.
Who was Christine when you were at Phantom? Was it Rebecca Luca or Barbara Russell?
When I first started, when I opened the show, it was what's her name? Andrew's wife. I can't remember her name. Rebecca was understudying, and Patty Konar was the matinee Christine. And when Patty moved up and took over the role, Rebecca became the matinee person, then eventually did the role. But I was gone by then, although I had worked with her a bunch of times before that, so that was really neat. She was so special. Yeah, when Sarah left, then it was Patty Konar, and then Rebecca moved up. And I wasn't there when Rebecca finally took the reins of the role of Christine. I don't think I got to see her do it either. She must have been spectacular.
Yeah, I agree. You did a lot of Broadway shows, and you even took Grease on the road. How hard is it to take a Broadway show on the road?
Oh, well, it depends. Grease happened when I was a baby. I mean, before I ever played on Broadway, I went out on the road with Grease. I had done Jesus Christ Superstar on the road. I did a bunch of things in regional theater and in stock, as we used to say. I don't know if they use that term anymore. But then I was hired. Do they? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, he doesn't care what the term is. He finds appropriate.
I like stock.
You like stock. Well, yeah, I did a lot of it. a lot of it. And it was fun. It was a fun way to spend your summer and make some money, you know, but and get to do shows that you would never get to do otherwise. People would let you do major roles out there that you might not ever get to do in an, you know, truly important performance, you know. And the productions were terrific, and it was a lot of fun. I went out with Grease in 1973. And oh, by the way, just sidebar, Grease is now celebrating its 50th anniversary. It just happened. And in June, we're going, actually, Mary Lou Henner, who was my roommate on that tour, and played Marty, of course, and she's brilliant. She's literally brilliant, and she's incredibly talented as well. She's going to be doing her evening, a club act that she does at 54 Below. I think it's June. Well, everybody check if you're interested. June 1st through the 7th or something. Anyway, two of those nights are going to be Grease nights. And I am, dear God, I am going to participate and try to revive my Rizzo role for that, those two shows. And then we're going to have a wild party, which is what we always did best anyway, was crazy parties with that company.
Oh, I'm sure.
Did you play that party trick with her that you like to do where you give her a day and then you remembers everything that you did that day?
She always could do that, and they hadn't put a name to it. But I remember, even when we were like roommates, you could never get anything by her because, you know, she remembered every second of her life. I mean, it's an extraordinary condition. That's capability. Fair. I don't know what you call it. For her, yeah. I don't think it's been a terrible thing. I don't know if she enjoys it exactly, but it hasn't been a curse for her. She's such a positive individual. I think that comes across in her work. She's beautiful inside and out, and really bright, besides having this amazing ability to remember every millisecond of your life, her life, anytime she was anywhere near you, she'll tell you the second something happened. It's pretty amazing.
Wow. Yeah, there's a term for that. I've got the word.
There is a term. And I don't know it. I've heard it more than once, and I have not retained it. So there you go.
You and I both.
You made your Broadway debut understudying for Madeline Kahn in the 20th century. What was it like understudying Madeline Kahn and then taking over for her, because you're the only one who could hit that
B5 high note.
Yeah, I'm not sure I was the only one who could have hit that B flat. I think any number of brilliant people. I think Madeline could have hit that B flat. She just chose not to. But in fact, I know she could have. In her sleep, she could have. It was another version of an out-of-body experience, because I was hired kind of unwillingly to be her cover. I'd understudied once in college, and I had a really bad experience doing it. It was very frustrating for me. And I thought, that's a job I never want to do in the theater. It's that, and especially being a swing, those are the hardest, except for the stage managers and the, you know, those are the hardest working people in the business. And I just, but once I took the job, I didn't want it. I turned it down like three times. And then I thought, oh my God, I'd be working with Hal Prince, and I had never done a huge Broadway show from its inception. I had taken over parts, but I had never created a role on Broadway. And I thought, all right,
it's a big leap.
I'll do this, and I'll create the role of Agnes the Maid. Mm-hmm. And on a good night, I could get 8 laughs with Agnes the Maid, who you know, I was Lily Garland's maid, Matt Mettlenkahn's maid in the show. And I was just kind of doing my job, and every chance I had when she didn't feel like rehearsing, they needed somebody to plug in for something. I said, hey, use me, because I'll learn the part. And someday, maybe in stock, I'll get to play the part. It really occurred to me that that's where it might happen, out in the hustings, in stock, in a straw hat circuit somewhere, I would get to play that part. And lo, when it was deemed that she was going to be unable to continue in the part, they, instead of going out and getting another great star to do it, they offered the lowly understudy the job. And who was I to turn that down? No. So it was my entire career has been a series of out of body experiences, of amazing occurrences, you know, where I'm just kind of doing my gig and something happens and it's surprising and amazing. And I have done my homework. That's the main thing, especially in that situation. I knew what I was supposed to do. I was current with what the script was. And when they needed me, I was ready to go on, and I was able to pull it off. You know, I think most people who are understudying have that opportunity, and usually in New York for sure. Every time I go to a show in New York, I'm astounded by the brilliance of everybody on that stage. So in my opinion, any number of people could have done what I did, but I was the lucky one who was there at that moment, in that time, in that costume, ready to go on. And it was incredible. I have to tell you that when I took over, the morning after I took over, and for the first time, there was another time when I won the Tony for Phantom, that my face was on, yes, the front page of the New York Post. Not the newspaper you kind of want to be on the front page of, but hey, it was that one. Right. Anyway, that afternoon I was on the subway, and that picture, that newspaper was on the floor of the subway, and people That's were weird. Stomping on it. And I said, okay, well, this is a reality check. This is what all of this really means. I in no way cure cancer enough. You know, I had a great time, and it was important for my work career and for the opportunity to get to keep doing what I love doing, which is telling stories live on stage. You know.
Yeah, that hits you hard, right? When you see that, it's like, wow. Yeah, all of a sudden you're in the papers. And.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's ephemeral. It's the whole thing. Even if you're on film, you're there for longer. But in life, you still kind of, it's ephemeral. It's here today. And
yeah, all of a sudden, right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure it doesn't feel like, you know, 30, 20 years ago, however long it was, you know.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure that time went by very fast.
Yeah, and that's why.
It was great. You know, I loved every second of it. I mean, yeah.
I can imagine.
How did you get involved with Mamma Mia?
Oh, well, they made me audition for. It was a very lengthy audition process. Oh, yeah, it was very lengthy. I don't know. They were not sure, I guess. But it went on and on and on. And then they hired me. And I was about ready to not do it. And then I'm so glad I did. Because I had the time of my life doing that show. Everybody around me knew I would, and I was very grateful for my 2 years at the Winter Garden Theater playing Rosie. Yeah, it was fabulous. It was just so much fun, and to be in front of an audience that loves you that much.
Yeah,
you know, it feels really, really, really good.
I remember. One time, I was at, you know, the auction after Mamma Mia, and there was a bid to have your picture taken with the Dynamos in the Mega Mix outfit, and I won it, and I have a Polaroid picture of you and me, and your arm is around me.
Where's the picture? I need to see the picture.
I cannot find it.
Oh, I wish I had it. We did a bunch of those for Broadway Cares, you know. Yeah, that was really fun to do. Because the folks, I mean, I'm sorry, I don't remember that, but that's only because we did a bunch of those, and they were all so positive because everybody was having the best time. It just loved it, so and we loved sharing that with people. I mean, that was the point of that show. It was to share all this joy.
Sure.
It looked fun. I saw it the day after the 9/11, and every single person was up in the aisles dancing and singing with you guys.
Going crazy.
You could not see it, but it was literally a party in the aisles.
Every night. And after 9/11, I mean, you have everybody who's a New Yorker definitely knows what that always felt like. But the one of the first, well, maybe you were part of this. It was a theater party, and it was mostly, as I recall, young men in suits. Must have been some kind of a fundraiser or something. And when those guys with their ties all kind of open and wild looks in their eyes, like they hadn't smiled in weeks, and they came rushing up the aisles right to the stage. That was incredible. That was astounding, and took my breath away. I mean, we were feeling the same way they were. Some people called the show the Lords of Broadway. You know, like when you're sick, you go to the patron saint or something, and I had calls from people, friends who were having difficulties in their lives, and they called me, said, please, I've got to come and see the show tonight. I need this show. It had that effect on people. It has that effect on people. Yeah. I got to believe sometimes they're going to bring it back. I will be doing it on a walker if they ask me to do it. Hey, Jesse Walker, birthday. But it was an amazing time. Yet another amazing time doing what I do.
Was it true that you only had 42 seconds to get into your red jumpsuit?
Oh, it was really quick.
I heard.
Yes. Yeah, the women had, the guys had a long time to get into it. But we had to really get in there fast, yeah.
I heard that it was 42.
Somebody clocked it.
That's kind of a long, fast change, actually. If 42 seconds is so, like, you know, you might have a smoke and a beer. No, sometimes, I mean, if you think about, I've done some much faster changes than that. And I know, for instance, Gina and Diana, some of hers were actually on stage, let's face it. But they were a few seconds, just, you seconds, know, like 10 seconds, 5 seconds, boom, changed. Mm-hmm. And it takes a lot of people to do that. You're not doing that on your own, I can promise you.
Right.
Yeah, and you made an appearance on the Rosie O'Donnell show.
Yeah. She was she's such a promoter and a fan of Broadway, and now she's played it a couple of times. She was great to us. She was very, very kind and a lot of fun. And that was not a bad thing. That was fun.
that I am in the epic clip right here.
Do you?
Mamma Mia is Broadway's newest blockbuster hit. It features the songs of ABBA, tells the story of a single mom on the eve of her daughter's wedding. When things go awry, her best friends desperately try to cheer her up by reminiscing about the past days as a girl group. Here to perform Dancing Queen, please welcome Louise Petra. I said that right. Karen Mason and Judy Kay, the cast of Mamma Mia.
You haven't done anything to be ashamed of.
Yeah, screw them if they can't take a joke.
I'm frozen. I'm frozen here. How do I get back?
Those are the days when I could do that.
Oh, I can still do it.
Why are you so slow? Your voice is slowed down. You're in slow motion.
Oh, really?
How do I fix that?
I don't know.
I got a technical problem. I got a phone call in the middle of that, in the middle of my Zoom there. So I'm, how do I speed you up? What do I do?
I don't know. Now, can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're actually fine.
Yeah? No?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, thumbs up.
Yep.
Something has happened here. While that was going on, should I exit StreamYard and come back to you?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can always try that. That's fine.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Should I do that? Let's do that.
Yeah.
Let's go back over to StreamYard.
Okay.
I can still hear them. So they didn't leave. Let's see.
Exit and then come back. But you can't hear us. She can't hear you? Yeah. I
can hear both of you. Oh, really? That's interesting.
A beauty! Okay, we move. Beauty, can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, we can. Yep. We can.
Okay. Yeah, these things happen.
Yeah.
They do, don't they?
Yeah.
It's okay.
Now,
it's
all right. I'm talking about one of my favorite characters that you created, which is Duchess Estonia Dwarf. You can get it.
I'm so glad you like her.
Now, tell me what went into the creative process in creating her.
Well, you know, she's, as I said a little while ago, she was the product of an actual movement that happened sort of in the early 20th century, late 19th century, where British lords were running out of money. And there were all these, for some reason, and I don't know how this happened, but there were a lot of American women who had inherited a great deal of money. And so they would meet and marry, and these British men and these aristocracy and these women with a lot of money. And so that's what she did. And she was not one of the most attractive of those women who had that happen to them, but she experienced that. So here she is. And she has become, she's very much against liquor, to put it mildly. She was what do we call those women? They were teetotaling, abolitionists. No, they weren't abolitionists. They were called something else. Help me, somebody who has a brain. Where she was against all forms of amusement, actually. She was against anything that was fun, let's face it.
Debauchery.
Yes.
Debauchery.
And so when Cookie McGee accidentally, on purpose, gets her absolutely loaded, then her life changes. She's had an out-of-body experience. And you see this thing that I'm wearing on my wrist? Can I show it to you? This is a product of swinging on a chandelier for two years, deadlifting myself. That and my back problems and my knee problems. But I would do it all again because it was so damn much fun.
Yeah. And Joe DePete was one liner that you killed. Those jokes that Joe wrote for you, oh my God, they are so funny.
Well, it's a very funny script. I think Joe is quite brilliant. So, and I wasn't the first choice for that role. I often am not, which is, it worked out very well. It was not written for me at all, but it was one of the happiest, wonderful accidents of my life to find myself in that show and playing that woman. You know, I've gotten to the point where in my life where those are the kind of roles that I am offered, and that's not a bad thing at all. Actually, it's a lot of fun. He wrote just marvelous stuff for that character. God knows, for Cookie, you know, Michael McGraw, who is totally brilliant. He's a great performer. You know, he's one of the best we have.
As you know, because you helped me with it, we did it in December, and the Estonia that we had, I had to do all of your ad-libs and all of your, I put everything back that you did in for her, and she nailed it.
Yeah, she did a good job.
She did a great job. You all did. You did a lovely, lovely job with it. And for such an incredible cause, it was an honor to be part of it.
Yeah. And you won your second Tony Award.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
Well, I think that had everything to do with working with Michael. Actually, I think he and I hit it off, and we found a way into that relationship, into that comedy. He was, and I think we also had an understanding of those old shows and those kinds of characters, and I think everybody in that show actually did. Kelly was wonderful, of course, and Matthew, my God, Matthew. Every time I hear or get to see a clip of those two guys, those kids, doing those dance numbers, and he had never done anything like that in his life, and it scared him a little bit, I think, but he applied himself, and he had just had back surgery on top of it. Wow. And the two of them just did a fabulous job. And I got to be part of it, and it was really fun playing off of all of that. That was that's what makes that stuff really work. Is not only is it great on the page, but you've got the people ham and egging it. You know, we get to, you know, toss the ball to each other. You receive the comedy, and then you pop it back to the next person.
That was an hour version where, like, you know, throwing the ball back and forth. And...
Yeah. You feed off each other's performance, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it had everything to do with it. How she helped us with all of that, and with the movement of it all, and just the whole production of it. It was a delight, and I loved being in it. They had to close it to get me out of there, you know. So... I'd still be there,
probably.
Right, you'd
still be there.
I'm a walker, because there's not much left of me after all of that. I call my body the wages of physical comedy. So it's, but I would do it all over again. I would change a thing.
Went walking the Shaggy and eat that.
Oh, when... Shaggy.
Yep, and whenever Michael and Neve found them, then it would go on, and it would be like very fun.
Yeah, Shaggy.
Did you get to see Shaggy do it? Did you get to see him do the role?
No, but I got to see the Wanderer. you know, about a week ago, and it really in your only week, which I have, you had.
Of course, you do.
I do.
I guess chandeliers have been very, very good to me. I want to thank the Tony nominators, all of the Tony voters. Thank you so much. I want to thank the audiences across the country I have played before over the last several years. It's so good to be back on Broadway at the Imperial Theater, and the audiences there have been magnificent. I want to thank everyone associated with Nice Work, if you can get it, our gorgeous cast, crew, company, the best damn band on Broadway, our creative team. I want to thank Jody Pietro, Kathleen Marshall, Marty Pakladinas, and especially David Chase for his wonderful arrangements. I want to thank my friend and agent Robert Malcolm. He's been watching over me like a mama cat for years now. On a personal note, I want to thank my darling husband, David Green, who knows how to, the care and feeding of the diva. He's, thank you for your unwavering love and support. I want to dedicate this to my dad. We lost him last week. And like me, he was a lifelong fan of the brilliance of George and Ira Gershwin. Thank you, Daddy, and thank you all. Good night.
What was it like winning your second Tony?
Well, it was pretty unbelievable. I mean, one is incredible, two is kind of ridiculously wonderful. And sharing it with Michael, because this time it was about a shared experience. It was really, and I had just lost my dad, and that was very meaningful, because this was the kind of thing, this kind of show he would have absolutely loved. Oh my God, he would have loved it. So it was a little bittersweet in that regard, but because of the hard work we had all done together and that wonderful, as I said, ham and egging all of this comedy and honing these moments together and sort of living and breathing off of each other, all of us, it was really marvelous. It was marvelous. It was, I'm a lucky girl.
Yeah. And then you followed that up by the Fairy Godmother in Cinderella.
Right, I got to do that.
How was that? Because you had to learn magic and you flew at the same time.
And that was hard. I should have asked them to change the keys, because singing and flying at the same time are not easy, because it takes, especially if the songs are very high, you have to have a firm core, you know, you have to support all that sound. That was challenging. I love the piece. Of course, I grew up with the piece, but I love doing it. And it was a great opportunity. Some wonderful people had played it before me, and it was beautiful. The magic of the costume changes. I mean, I did one of those magical costume changes, and I was, you know, this close to somebody else doing one. I still can't tell you how it was done. Even though I did it, I have no idea how it was done. It's amazing.
When you replace somebody, how hard is it to replace can you talk a little about replacing somebody? How long do you have to be Earth? You know, things like...
Well, it depends. You know, they give you about a week at Mamma Mia. I mean, at Wicked. You're there. The first time I went in, when I first took the part, I had a few weeks, but a lot spaced out rehearsals, very, very leisurely, which was kind of lovely. So I got to really sort of ingest it, make it my own. Sometimes, at least in the old days, they wanted you to do basically the exact same performance of the person you were replacing. And that's impossible. That's impossible because we are not, when we get up in the morning, identical to each other. And even though the words may be the same and the costume is the same, choices cannot be the same. So I have had an experience where a director tried to direct me into somebody else's performance. That just doesn't work. You have to start with whoever you are. If you're directing somebody, you have to start with whoever, whatever they bring to the table. You hired them, you need to trust them.
Because you were replacing Rebecca Luker.
She hadn't done it right before me because I'm having another brain fart. Originated
Vicky.
Thank you, Victoria, who is only one of the most brilliant human beings that ever walked the face of the planet. I know Rebecca had done it. I didn't get to see her do it. Vicky was back in the show, and then she was leaving the show, and then I came in for I actually closed it. So that was extraordinary. I loved doing it. I loved the relationship between the fairy godmother and Cinderella. I loved working closely with that character, and it was an astonishing moment in the show because for the first time a young woman of color was coming in to play that part. And one of the most exciting things was watching the audience and seeing young girls of color come in to see that show who may never have seen that show and seeing the possibility of themselves up there. And that was very, very moving and very important, I think. And it was a joy to be part of that experience in that moment.
So what next for you? What is
what's next?
Your
next?
Are you
I don't
coming?
Know. Well,
are you
Monday coming? Night I got a job.
Are you coming back the Broadway or you can't?
Act? If they'll have me. Yeah, sure, if they want me. But Monday night I'm gonna be on Broadway. I'm going to be up at Symphony Space, which is on Broadway at 95th Street, something like that. We are doing a gala concert for Symphony Space of A Little Night Music. And I'm very excited about doing that. Working with Carolee Carmello again. We did a show called Saving Amy a billion years ago out in Seattle. So I admire her so much. It's going to be fun. It's a beautiful, beautiful show, and it's such an incredible score. So yeah. I'm excited about that. And we spend all day together on Monday, and then we get up at night and I will just for safety's sake hold a book. So, but I'm playing Madame Armfelt. That's where I am now. So I love it. It's a beautiful song she has.
You are using binders?
We are. We will. We have been invited to do so if we want them, and I will keep it there. I've learned the song that I want to do it justice, and I want to make sure that because we don't have a lot of rehearsal, that I want to be. Yeah. Important thing is to sing the song the way it was written, right?
I love a good I love a good binder, can't I?
Sure, you bet.
Yeah, that's the way we're doing all your cup this year. We're doing all your cup by and we have this phenomenal cast who's doing the unbelievable production of All Your Cup right now.
Yeah.
And
Just taking that cast and putting me in as the geek. And and then we're just doing it.
That's great.
You know, that's great. I didn't want to thank you again for doing this. Thank you. It means
my pleasure, Jesse.
It meant a lot to me.
Well, it means a lot to me too. And thank you. Thank you for having me and asking me. And I very much appreciate it. And thank you for being an ardent and passionate fan of the Broadway theater. And helping everybody around you to be as passionate about it as you are, and doing the concerts that you do, and I thank you, and I'm sure a whole lot of other people thank you.
You're welcome, and thank you for doing those videos for me.
My pleasure.
Thank you again.
Yeah, it's truly an honor.
Thank you. Really,
have a great summer.
I will.
Great. Thanks, you too.
Bye.
Thanks you for doing it.
Bye-bye.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.